One of your best thanks. That's it. Make it a Guinness. Thank you. Cheers.
On a tide of pure adrenaline, I proudly made my way through the main streets of Manhattan in the mighty USA. I was cruising with conviction. I was craving for the gig. When I bit that awesome apple, folks, my appetite was big. From the continent down under, I confess my life was caught in a true and honest love affair with battles built on sport. Though my New York friends assured me, for you hero-hungry types, there ain't no greater worship than the sport of stars and stripes. You check out any anthem, son, the spirit in their eyes when they see that banner spangled with the stars that make them rise. And the thought just made me thirsty, so I headed for a jar in the firefighters' drinking hole they call McSorley's Bar. And I thought it rather odd as when I entered for that ale, a cheeky chestnut thoroughbred was tethered to the rail. But his eye looked so determined, and I shared the feeling too, so with eager stride I stepped inside and ordered me a brew. Well, then something eerie happened, and I swear in sober tones that the incident to follow sent a shiver through my bones. I'd only blown the froth off one. I'm telling you the truth. By sitting in that corner, well, it seemed to be Babe Ruth. And then my heart began to gallop in a mesmerizing fluster when I realized he was drinking with the Say Hey Kid and Buster, the Iron Horse, Lou Gehrig, wow, and good old Willie Mays. Then Mickey Mantle joined them while the boss sang Glory Days. As the jukebox carved a vision that would never pass me by, across the barroom floor, I saw a human being fly. In a bullish kind of singlet with the number 23, there was Mr. Michael Jordan reaping havoc in the key. He was in a round with Magic Johnson, Kobe, Wilt, Shaquille, and then Kareem served up a skyhook just to seal the goddamn deal. When another MJ entered, something fabulous was flowing. Yes, Michael Johnson took a stool right next to Jesse Owens. Well, the scene was unbelievable. My jaw was on the floor. Much to my excitement, though, the menu offered more when I overheard Ron Turcotte talking triple crowns with pride. "How's the champ?" I asked. Ron said he's tied up right outside. I knew it looked familiar. Secretariat, of course. The tingle down my spine then felt a surge of extra force when the shadow of Babe Diedrichsen announced her humble throne as the greatest ever sportswoman the world had ever known. Well, the ground began to rumble then, from sea to shining sea. I looked around. My God, there stood the figure of Ali. He was shaking hands with Smokin' Joe and Sugar Ray as well, with Louie too, and someone shouted, "Please don't ring no bell." The greatest with the greatest, folks. The coolest with the cool. 'Twas then I noticed Michael Phelps and Mark Spitt shooting pool. In a version of mixed doubles that descended from the heavens, Phelps with Natalie Coughlin playing Spitz and Janet Evans. Across the bar, a shot was served. Oh, that Grand Slam crew had earned it. With a blazing backhand rocket, Andre Agassi returned it. Pete Sampras in a forehand flash, continue with the honors. John McEnroe, a topspin lob, a smash from Jimmy Connors. Billie Jean was looking on. The Williams sisters cheered in his red shirt for the final round. Then Tiger Woods appeared, and I hardly need to tell you there was gospel in the air. The Tiger sharing secrets with his friend, the Golden Bear. Well, it was stunning to be gunning with this epic all-star crew. "Next round's on the house," proclaimed the barman, Willie Shue. And a wave of immortality made that drink even greater when I downed it on a barrel with my arm round Kelly Slater. Bo Jackson joined the action. He was celebrated twice. Chris Chelios then raised his stick and ordered extra ice. He was sipping from the Stanley Cup. And even more amazing, the Duke rode in on Man of War with all his big guns blazing. But how could you believe it if you weren't on hand to see it? Trust me, this was happening. In fact, I guarantee it. You nameth me the football legends underneath that banner, and I'll give the show to Broadway Joe. I'll roar the name Montana. They were there with Walter Payton, Jerry Rice, and Big Jim Brown, with LT bustin' bad guys, Emmett Smith was touching down, Ray Lewis on the door let Barry Sanders join the party, and all of them were toasting to the guru, Vince Lombardi. Way too overwhelming for a tragic like myself. A smorgasbord of champions, the cream of life's top shelf. Then a hush descended calmly. Not a soul was heard to talk when Frank Sinatra climbed the bar and sang, "New York, New York." The news was spreading proudly. Blue Eyes put it in the bag. He paused for just a moment. Then he looked up at the flag. His hat removed, his voice then played its patriotic part, and every person in that barroom sang with all their heart. I was singing with emotion as the anthem filled the sky. I was singing with a tear of greatness swirling in my eye. To the brave and to the brilliant, to the perfect place to be, to the fallen, not forgotten, to the country of the free. But somewhere in that moment, when the bombs burst into air, I opened up my eyes. No way. The room around was bare. Well, that song still on my lips, and yes, the smile still on my face, but everyone had disappeared. They'd gone without a trace. It was then I realized sadly, and the truth dawned in my head. I wasn't in no barroom. I was sitting up in bed. So I stood and drew the curtains on Manhattan's morning gleam as the rising sun confirmed. Damn, it was only just a dream.